Hey, good evening, everyone. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. It's my Monday 100-minute podcast of the What Would Jeff Do radio show. So we do these Monday and Wednesday night podcasts. We do them for 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We do them for 100 minutes. It's important to go for all 100 minutes. So what I want folks to do is I want folks to, in your chat box, I want you to put in your questions, and I want you to put in to admin only and then chat. So if you don't put in admin only, everybody sees it. And, you know, it's no big deal. It just, I like to protect and privatize all my fans. And these are for you. The reason why I do these webinars is because I get, over a dozen probably emails and Facebook questions. Thank you. Facebook questions a day. And this is the best way for me to get back to people. And it offers a lot of free stuff, obviously. So between Monday night, Wednesday night, and Saturday radio show, what I can do is I'm able to do so much free content. So I really enjoy doing it. But I need people to ask questions. So without you, because again, I'll hold up my universal blank page. Ah, Caroline wrote me a book. Oh yeah, 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 yeah. All right, Caroline, let me get right to you. Oh my gosh, Australia. Hey, awesome. Hey, thanks for chiming in from Australia. I got to get out there. I get a lot of emails from Australia. I just got to figure out where in Australia to go. I don't know anything about the cities. And then also, I don't know if I want to do the flight. It's a 27-hour flight from the East Coast. I guess the only time I would do it is next time I go out to, I'm going to be in Germany this weekend. If I go to Germany, that's 7 hours. So now we're down to a 20-hour flight. So maybe that wouldn't be so bad to do it from Germany. Dear Jeff, greetings from Australia. We have a 14-week-old band dog named Mac. Prior to getting him, I have been doing quite a bit of research to educate myself on how to best train this beautiful boy. I totally love your work and thanks for all your free training videos. You're welcome. They're so helpful. That's the point, and I'm glad you find them helpful. I sincerely do. Mac is now able to sit and stay on command, and heals pretty good, which is awesome. There are a couple of issues I would like your opinion on. When I take Mac for a small walk, he tends to get very excited about certain cars and certain people, dogs, and likes to chase birds. All age appropriate. Don't worry about any of this stuff so far. He heals pretty well for a pup. However, he sometimes just pulls and lunges out of nowhere. He seems to get these spastic moments, and I'm not sure how to snap him out of it. I'm getting tougher as he's now eight. It's getting tougher as now he's 18 kilograms. And for all you people out there that are not on metric, which is the whole United States, we can do the math easily by multiplying by 2.2. So that would be 1830. That'd be 36, and then 36, about 38 pounds. Okie doke. Where am I here? God, we're in this universal scroll. Oh, that is a different one. Oh, Drew, you threw us off. I've watched your videos online and how to teach heel, and he responds quite well. It's just that when he sees something exciting, new, that he totally loses interest in me. What would Jeff do? Mac only sometimes drops while he's down on commands. I really need to do my hand signals very clearly, and he needs to know I have a treat. I would like him to lie down on command even when I stand, but he doesn't understand it. So obviously I'm doing something wrong. I've tried your method with stepping on the leash, but he totally doesn't get it. What should I do to teach my pup to lie down on command? Thanks a million. Greetings from Australia. First of all, kudos to you, Caroline. But number one, you got a 14-week-old dog. Relax. You're doing okay. You're doing fine. Let's not use treats. Let's use the dog's daily food. All right, so let's get off of anything special, and let's use the dog's daily food, and let's just train that dog with its daily food. So everything you want that dog to do, it's going to work for its meals. So there's a video that I did with come, sit, break, come, sit, break. We use the word here, so it could be here, sit, break. Do that. Do a lot of focus work. There's another focus video. And then do your food for sit, do the food for place, and do the food for down. With down, what I would do is at the beginning, you're going to want to do 100 times down leash pressure food, leash pressure food, leash pressure food, leash pressure food. And then eventually you don't have to use leash pressure and you won't be bending over. But you have a 14-week-old dog. Be careful about doing too much too soon. All right? So as far as the lunging on the leash, 14-week-old dog that's 18 kilos, you can start using a prong collar. I would suggest that. And then what's happening with prong collars is a lot of people wait until the dog lunges before they give the dog the proper information. So with your dog, what I would like you to do, and remember, when you use a prong collar, especially on a young dog, but it's a big dog, dogs are going to be sensitive by nature. So you want to make sure it's not going to be like your regular flat buckle collar or a martingale. If you're on a harness with your dog and it's pulling, unfortunately, your dog is going to continue to pull. Can you train a dog on a harness to not pull? I'm sure you can, but I don't. So I can't give you advice on that. I'm not a big fan of them. So I don't want you to do that. So try there, but don't give yourself such a hard time. Your dog is just resisting to the down. Down is a pretty invasive thing for dogs to be doing. A lot of times it puts a lot of pressure on them. So use food, do whatever it takes to get that dog to a down. Okay. Terry says, you can fly to Australia by breaking it into legs, fly to the West Coast, do a seminar, fly to Hawaii. So rough, do a seminar, fly to Australia, do a seminar. That's true. Actually, good point, Terry. Actually, I've got clients in Australia. I mean, in Hawaii. So I would love to do that. So I can do West Coast and then Hawaii. That's a good idea. So I'll plan that for 2016. I think also Australia is on a different season than us. I believe so. I said, so during our winter is their summer, if I remember correctly. So we can do that. Now I just got to figure out what city, what township or that I should do it in to get the most. I know that balance training is in demand there. And I know that it's expensive, which is fine. I mean, we're expensive too, but doing a 2-day seminar could be a lot of fun. Doug, at an adoption event, a notoriously hard puller was settled with his handler who had him on a prong collar and the carabiner on the flat collar. I asked him how he happened to do that. And he told me he saw my results that I had shown that Jeff Gellman uses. A good day. That's good, Doug. Thank you. It's always good to know that people see our videos. I don't care whose videos you see, just watch a video. There's no, they're really, with technology out there, there really isn't, a reason not to have a fully trained dog. So for instance, Webinar Jam just came out with a brand. Webinar Jam is what you guys are watching this on. It's a Google Hangout platform. They just came out with a brand new piece of software. So pretty soon, starting next month, I think I'm doing 4 more webinars that are going to be on this platform, and then eventually you won't know any difference. Your login stuff will be the same. The invitation might look a little bit different that you sign into, but on my end, there's dramatic change going on. So I'm not computer savvy, believe it or not, but guess how I'm going to learn? I'm going to watch a bunch of videos. So Webinar Jam is supplying a ton of videos. I'll watch them. I'll write down notes. I'll try things. I'll do some pretend webinars, and then we'll get the webinar. I mean, it's all out there, guys. Everything is out there. The only thing that's not out there is my freaking throat spray, which I'm going to need. Can you grab that bottle next to the white bottle? Thank you. It's not breath spray. I ain't kissing this chick, so don't get excited. It's not that kind of webinar, okay? It's not what we do here. It's not what we do. Caroline says, thanks a million, Jeff, for your answers. I'm excited to continue to work with him. And yes, we'd love to see you in Australia. So Caroline, emailing me or Facebook messaging me like potential locations. So what I need is I need an existing training center would be nice. And can we get 30 to 40 people? And can we get 15 to 17 dogs? It would be 2 days. It would be a lot of remote collar training and balance training. We'd use all different training tools. price wise, I'll tell you exactly what I need to make in order to make it worth my while. Okay. So let's get rid of that question. Okie doke. God, I hope they have a better way to do the new webinar jam series. Yep. Okay, Jill wants me to do a poll. I'll do a poll, Jill. Thank you. Is your dog in place or in town while you watch the webinar? No. Yes or no? Yes. No. All right. So I'm doing a poll. And the poll is your dog in place or in a down while you watch the webinar? So if you go to your poll area, you'll find out. Okay. There you go, Jill. Jill says, half an hour ago, for the first time ever, I caught Zane counter surfing. I was shocked. Tomorrow will be fun. He won't know what hit him. Act of God. And to no surprise, it was cat food with a sedative in it. Not good. Called our vet and they said he'll only be slightly sleepy. Or you can put hydrogen peroxide down the dog's throat. Is that what you use? Don't take medical advice from me, Jill. Hydrogen peroxide. Yeah. Hydrogen peroxide down your dog's throat. Make him throw up. You can do that. Katie says, when and how do you suggest phasing out food rewards? Katie, since we remote cow or train the dog, I would start phasing out food rewards probably once the dog is remote collar literate. And once the dog gets really excited about working on the remote collar and the dog is responding to remote collar pressure, that's what I would do. During the learning phase, you can use food rewards, but then during the proofing phase, you want to take the food rewards out. And then obviously during the correction phase, you don't want to use the remote or the food. You would only use the remote for non-compliance. Okay. Okay. Let's go to Drew's question. Let's see, Claire, you got to do the poll question. Do the poll. Don't write your poll answers. Do the poll question. There's a poll. It's a yes or no question. That's it. It's a yes or no question. Sort of like, does your dog bite? So when a client comes in, we have them fill out a form anyway, but when a client comes in and I said, has your dog ever bit a human before? And if they go, I'm like, that's a yes, because it's a yes or no question. And the thing is, I understand why a lot of people hesitate, why a lot of owners hesitate, is because they hesitate because they've been kicked out of training centers before. I just want to know if I'm going to get bit today. That's all. You know, we don't mind that your dog bites. We've got 3 aggressive dogs on the property right now. And, you know, it's always a bite risk. Oh, there was a photo that I had up on, with the new software, we can be able to put that photo right up on there. Yep. And Diana's looking at all her new logos right now. Diana could be able to put up like as a poll question, like, hey, which logos do you like? Right. Wouldn't that be awesome? Yeah. You email me the logos between 2 or 3. Or 4 or 5, actually, I can put up a poll and I can say, okay, rate these. We can do all kinds of fun stuff.
I know. I'm excited.
Yeah, I gotta, when I'm over in Germany, I'll have a little bit of downtime. I'm going to, I'm in the air. On the plane. I can't do it on the plane.
I'm sure there's Wi-Fi.
No, it's astronomically, no. Oh. Okay. There probably is Wi-Fi, but I'm not going to do it. Okay. But I got enough to read. I got so much reading material. Mm. It's incredible. I got like 8 magazines to get through. And then I've got, I got a lot of work to do. I'm looking forward to, maybe I should go to Australia. I would love to spend 27 hours on a plane.
just to catch up.
Yeah. Right. I would love it. Drew says, hey Jeff, I recently adopted a 1.5-year-old lab Ridgeback mix named Dublin, who proved to be too high energy and difficult to control for his previous owner. I don't blame you. Lab Ridgeback mix. Yep. That'll be energy. Since getting him a month ago, I have managed to turn him around into an impressively obedient dog who is calm and respectful of people. Awesome. Good. Great job, Drew. However, there is one issue he and I are continuing to struggle with. He has an aversion to certain dogs, and when he's around those dogs, he goes into panic, high anxiety state that consists of teeth showing and incessant barking. He seems to be reacting out of fear, which I assume was developed while living with his previous owner, who had another dog who was alpha, and a large black dog. Dog was a pain in the butt. I can say ass, actually. This isn't going to be on the radio. Dog was an ass. It seems that the dog who triggers behavior from Dublin are either larger in size, invade his personal space, or make excessive hard eye contact, mainly the last one. Those are the only factors that I can pick up on that causes reaction. Going to the vet is difficult because if there's one of these dogs in the waiting room, he goes nuts. I know, vet offices are hard. Only when he looks over at them and they're staring back at him. I try to keep his attention on me, which works. But when he occasionally looks back over at the dog, he locks back into panic mode. I'm unsure as to whether I should desensitize him to these dogs by exposing him to them with a muzzle on, correcting with a prong remote. Okay. All right. This is going to be a tricky one here, Drew. And this is one that I will try a lot of different stuff. I might break my rules. Who knows? So what I want you to do is this. I want you to do incredible focus work with this dog. The focus work we do show with food. There's a video underneath my how-to dog training section on my YouTube channel. I think it's like the second oldest video that's up there. I'm putting up a brand. Oh, my God. You missed this. Wait till you see this video. Oh, it's ready. I'm just going to do this. I'm just going to do this right now. It's the second oldest video that I've got up there. And I want you to be able to do that. So I would not allow my dog muzzled up to go up towards strange dogs. I don't want my dogs to meet dogs. So yes, my dogs meet dogs at my training center in a controlled environment where I have control over every single dog. That's it. I would never go to a dog park. When I'm at the beach or in the woods with my dogs, I keep them moving. I don't trust dogs and I don't trust people because a lot of dogs put too much pressure on dogs and a lot of dogs don't like that amount of pressure. So let's do this. Let's do focus work, remote collar focus work, and don't let your dog right now stare at other dogs. So break your dog's concentration with the remotes. All right? So let's do that. I was going to read a question so I can upload some stuff. Okay, don't worry about it.
I can't see him on mine.
That's okay. Doug says, have e-collar makers come up with a way to have electronic fencing right in a training collar like you use? Not that I'm aware of, Doug. I don't know how to pronounce your name or if that's a typo. And then Tia, Tia. Put for admin only when you ask a question. My friend's dog pees when he gets scared and excited. What can she do to prevent it? Number one, she should call into my show. She should attend my show. So there's no miscommunication whatsoever in the conversation, or you have to show her this thing. So what you want to do is the dog that's peeing, you want to keep it in a calm state. So a lot of times, nervous, anxious, fearful, excitement, pee, believe it or not, it can be corrected. And we have to keep dogs in a calm state. So what I want you to do is I want you to tell your friend to, when she comes in the house, don't get all excited. Stay neutral. Don't use high-pitched voices. Don't allow people to go, oh my God, I love your dog, and pet your dog. I would let nobody even pet that dog. I would be careful with any physical affection. I would be careful with any verbal praise. And then I would also making sure your dog is doesn't drink a lot of water. That probably won't make a difference because if it's nervous, stressful, pee, or fearful, none of that matters. Like, I can see how people in a really scary situation will lose bowel and bladder function and they could have been just in the bathroom. So that's got nothing to do with it. So what I would do though is, you want to keep the dog below a certain threshold until it builds up muscle memory. Also, it depends on how old the dog is and the size of the dog. Believe it or not, a lot of little dogs can't hold, they've got little bladders.
What if they get excited just like because of a person, period? Like there is no voice, you know, there's no affection, there's no high voices. It's just the whole, somebody's here.
Yeah, you're going to struggle.
Yeah,
it's gonna be a struggle. It's gonna be a major, okay. Yeah. It's gonna be a major. It's a major struggle. It's really hard to have dogs that that have got bladder issues. You know, one of my dogs, he Max passed recently, and he was incontinent, and we put him on a pill, and that fixed it. I personally have never owned, ironically, and I've owned a lot of dogs. Like right now, I think I've got 9, and none of them have got separation anxiety, and none of them have got pee issues. And that's why I'm a firm believer that separation anxiety is really, really owner induced. I'm not discounting, you know, medical stuff. Trust me on that. But I'm thinking that there's some owner induced stuff, because I've got a great video out there on separation anxiety. It's underneath my behavior modification section, which I'm adding to on my YouTube channel. My YouTube channel I'm restructuring. So what it is you'll be able to easily train your dog as well as solve problems. But for a lot of specific stuff, you want to go to my webinar, which is why I do these webinars. For really specific stuff of like how do you introduce dogs to each other, that's there's a lot of variables in order to do that. It's hard to do. And then aggression, I can't really give too much advice on aggression. I think it'd be unethical over the phone line, over the internet, in a video, because there's so many variables, and most dog owners don't understand what the triggers are, because you're dog owners. You know, you don't have the trained eye that a lot of dog trainers, most dog trainers don't even have a trained eye when it comes to aggression. They've got no clue what they're doing. Most dog owners and dog trainers, I've seen a lot of dog trainers that actually create aggressive situations, which are just horrific. They're just horrific. So, so that's where we hang out with her. Okay. Let's see. Tracy says, hi guys. I have a client with a 5-month-old bull mastiff that's super chill and doesn't seem to get excited about anything. The owners want him at least alert when someone comes to their door or pay attention when strangers come up. Okay. For those few dogs that owners do ask to get more excited, what protocols do you use? We're working on some focus work, and they are coming to a group class and he's slowly responding to social pressures.
I remember hearing you the last few days, just like, nobody comes and asks me to get their dog more excited.
I know. I'd be really careful. Not to be stereotypical, a lot of bull mastiffs are laid back. Like I've got 2 bull mastiff clients right now. Their dogs are, I believe, 7 months old, and they're like really laid back dogs. And you know what? We're going to leave it that way, because I've been attacked by a non-super chill bull mastiff, and that was an issue. So I had a bull mastiff put my whole midsection in its mouth. So the last thing I want is an overprotective or a protective bull mastiff. If they're really worried about home security, I suggest they get an alarm system. They get a gun, they get video surveillance, and they buy a barking chihuahua. And the barking chihuahua will signal, and then the bull mastiff will probably saunter up, dum 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 dum, and then the criminal will walk away because they'll see this humongous bull mastiff. So in my opinion, I would not encourage that bull mastiff to be unsuper chill. Just my opinion. So, so Tracy says, that's exactly what I told the owners. People pay good money for a dog like they have. Exactly. Taya says, he's a 6-year-old greyhound mix, whines in the car and out of the house. So the whining is anxiety. So that goes back to the pee thing. So the whining is the anxiety. The way we eliminate whining is we eliminate whining with remote collars. Remember, a remote collar is used to say no, and it's used to say go, and they can be very, very gentle. But I cannot stand whining. I hate it. I hate whining. I hate barking. And a remote collar is one of the most wonderful things to do to eliminate whining. So, can I touch you?
Yeah.
Okay. So pretend that Diana was starting to whine, so start whining. And I put my hand on her shoulder. I need you to relax. Start whining again. And I put my hand on my shoulder, hit relax. So she's never heard her whine. She spent 5 days in an RV with me once recently, and she didn't whine once. This is not a whine. This is not a whining woman. Trust me. If she was whining, a whining woman, she'd be in Ohio still. She would have made it. I would have definitely left you there with all those dogs. So what the remote collar does is it actually calms down the dog. It takes away all the stress. So, the dog is stressed. So imagine you've got something that de-stresses the dog, and that's how the remote collar works. See, a lot of times there's a lot of misinformation out there about remote collars where people think that they're made to just blast a dog if it's not listening. And that's just not, this is not true. It's just not true at all. So I think it's important that folks understand that a remote collar can be the best and usually is. And there's a lot of collars, a lot of lies. Owner's fault. And this is nothing. In my industry, there happens to be a lot of owner bashing. There happens to be a lot of dog trainer bashing. That's a whole alphabet. I'll address it because I know there's a lot of young dog trainers out there. And there's a lot of dog trainers that watch this show. And I want you to know, well, we'll talk about that for a little bit. Let's talk about that. So it's really funny. Our industry is funny. I think there's a lot of unprofessionalism. I think there's a lot of unethical people in our industry. I think there's people out there that don't understand that we are we should be professional dog trainers. And if you're a member of the International Professionals, which is the IACP, to behave. And I think that when you've got something that I get industry mind, I've got a lot of super fans out there, but I also have a lot of super haters. To me, that's a great barometer. I actually scale my success on the people that hate me. And it sounds a little bit weird. And don't get me wrong, I love my super fans that love me. I love you guys. I mean, that's what the show is for. But there's some folks out there that have been dog training for 20 or 30 years. And when you're in an industry for 20 or 30 years, in my opinion, you should be acting in a mentorship role. Okay? A mentorship role. And as a mentor, what you should be doing is you should be helping someone new in the industry be brought up to be great at what they do. The problem in our industry is you got a bunch of dog trainers that are burnt out. They're dealing with a lot of issues, personal issues, drug and alcohol issues, mental issues, like anything else, like a lot of us do. But the great thing is that a lot of the younger generation is learning how to deal with it. So you've got all these people that are sort of fixed in their ways, and they might have this. Only been training dogs for 1 to 5 years that you shouldn't be making money. You shouldn't be training dogs. You don't deserve to be training dogs. And what you should be doing is, Heather says that I'm losing my signal and I'm not quite sure why. Let me see here. I'm on the right network. I think that might be you. Anybody else? I'm losing a signal. That might be you, Heather. All right. Let me just go through all my things here. Nope. 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 So I'm not getting anything else. Okay. So what I want the mentors to be doing is you should be empowering young trainers. So what happens is this, the more successful I get, and the more seminars that I do, what a lot of trainers are doing is they've decided to take the low road. by trash talking and by bashing, which is fine because number one, it doesn't bother me. I actually find it quite funny that you call yourself a professional, but you're acting like a teenager or like a high school student. I actually find it humorous. So Stacy's losing the signal too. All right. So I don't know what to tell you on that. Are you on the internet?
Yeah.
You might have to get off the internet. Yep. Okay. A lot of people are losing my signal. So I don't know what to tell you. Losing the signal. Okay. Everybody's losing the signal. I was breaking up 2 minutes ago. The video went off. Actually, your signal has come in and out a couple of times. Okie doke. So keep breaking up. I've got... Okay. So let me see what I can do. I'm showing a very strong internet connection on my part. All right. I'm strong. Oh, better now. Maybe you were taking on my bandwidth.
Stealer
bandwidth. Right.
But some days it doesn't matter.
Yeah, I don't know. Well, we're still going to... Wow, Heather, you've lost me completely twice. So I don't know what to tell everybody. I'm showing good. This happens almost every show. I'm going to get a hard line. Run hard line up to offer. You know what I should probably do? I should just get a really powerful line installed. That's what I'm going to do. Let me call Cox just for this. I'll pay the monthly fee. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to get a separate line just for me, a dedicated line just for this show. We do this twice a week. Okay. So I don't know what to tell everybody. All right. Let me just get – no, okay. All right, guys. I got to clear up my board here. Okay, I keep breaking up. Okay, just like in high school. Okay. Okay. All right. So anyway, going back to the ethics. So what happens is this. The issue is when you've got a bunch of other professionals out there that are higher ups in my industry and you're doing your own seminars and you're trash talking myself and other seminar presenters, what you're doing is the attendees of those seminars, number one, it all comes back to me and I just laugh. But number two, you're losing credibility in our industry. So what you're doing is you think you're hurting me, but you're actually not. You actually bring joy and pleasure and happiness in my life because that's what I use as my scale of my success. So the way I look at it is this, the more people in the industry that don't like me, and you have to keep in mind, I'm a really nice guy. I'm a very loving, sharing, giving person. So it's not because I'm a total asshole that people don't like me. People don't like me because of my success. But let's also keep in mind that I started this business from zero, literally from zero. 10 years ago, my first clients, I had them pay what they could. I had them just pay what they could. I started those from zero. So anyway, okay. It's enough for that. So Nancy, let's see. Nancy. Nancy, there's a five-month-old. Let's see. I thought I was dealing with separation anxiety, but now I think the scenario is this. We have a huge 700-square-foot dog enclosure about 150 feet from the house where I put the dog when I'm working outside. Even though he can see me, whether at the house or on the tractor, he continues. After 3 days to screech and bark and drive himself into a frenzy, is there any way to correct this without a remote? Well, Nancy, why don't you want to use a remote? That's what I would ask you. Why wouldn't you want to use the best tool available for the dog? So to me, Nancy, your dog is in pain right now. Your dog is barking and screaming. And first of all, your dog has got too much freedom. So if you've got a 700 square foot, why don't you just leave your dog in the house in a crate or train your dog to be off leash? But why would you not want to use a remote? when a remote is the best tool. So Ant, I'd like to know why you don't want to use a remote. If you feel like it's something mean, I can respect that. But you know what? The state of mind your dog is in, the remote would never do. So the remote would never do that. So you would correct, and then the dog would most likely settle down. Correct, and you mostly settle down. Oh, got it. So Nancy just hasn't gotten the remote yet, but she's not averse to them. So go get your remote. And in the meantime, you're on the tractor, the dog's in the enclosure. You really can't do anything. You'd have to get off the tractor, go over to your dog, correct your dog, and then you'd get back on the tractor, and then it would start it again. I'd wait till you got the remote, and then I would remote collar train your dog, and then you can give the remote, whatever your dog freaks out, you can give your dog remote that it's let's see. Heather, okay, Heather. I got your private message. Thanks. We'll talk. All right. People are private messaging me, which is fine. Just kept making noise on my computer. All right. John and Jigsaw, this is from Allison. Hey, Allison, followed your tips from Wednesday on how to get a bath averse dog into the tub. Did it from the dog's lunch and dinner on Thursday and Friday. On Saturday, he was a reluctant but willing bather, clean puppy.
Nice work.
Awesome. That's with Allison. By the way, you're kicking butt. You got yourself a great husband. You got yourself a great family. And you guys are, there's not going to be anything out there that you cannot do. That you cannot do. So I love what you're doing with your family, and I love what you're doing with your dog. And kudos to you. And I'm so excited that I get to meet John and Jigsaw out in Ohio. Jill says, our vet has been letting us go behind the counter and in the back and do a few training sessions as long as we aren't in the way. You could ask your vet to do that as well. That's for the person that was struggling with their dog at with the vet's office. Yep. So you could do that. You can ask your vet if you can set it up and just go into the vet office and role play that over and over again. Nancy says, am I going to be able to set it up safely by myself with the directions and watching you demonstrate on yourself? As far as the remote collar, you don't need to demonstrate the remote collar on yourself. I don't have yet a full how to train your dog on a remote, but you can start doing sit, down, place, and being quiet on the remote. But you're asking your dog to do a lot, Nancy. You're asking a dog that's struggling with explosive energy, and the dog wants to be by you, and the tractor is a moving vehicle, and your dog is all excited. So what you need to do is, right now, I would just keep your dog inside the house, because I know you want your dog to be with you, but it's not being with you. It's creating nonsense. If your dog was in the house inside of a smaller kennel, it would be fine. Also, your dog has got too much space. So it's running around and it's building up all this anxiety. So what you're doing is your dog is doing some anxiety building activities. So let's keep your dog from doing those anxiety building activities.
Is that of an awesome family?
Which one? Yeah, I'm about to post a really great video. With a special needs kid? No. There's another video. You don't even know about it yet. You have no idea. You don't even know this boy yet. Oh. Matt. Yeah.
Okay, I thought it was that family.
Three great boys. Oh, questions, guys. You got to ask questions. Okay, there's no more questions. No more questions. The webinar's over because I can only talk for so long. Unless there's a topic you want me to talk about. Diana, anything you want to talk about?
I just hear, there's some people here involved with, they have kids or husband or wives, and that family I just brought up, I don't know, maybe not a big topic, but just how important it is and what a big difference it makes when everybody is on board with everything.
Right. So one of the magic is we're putting together a video of one of the most miraculous sessions that I've ever had is, was a family of a dog, one of the most intense leash reactive dogs that I've ever seen. There was a little 15 second video clip that I put up on my Instagram account. I think it was on Instagram, as well as on my YouTube channel. And they didn't have they didn't want to do a boarding train just because of budget wise. And I respect that. And I gave them homework. So they had this massively, massively leash reactive dog, would scream. I'm talking noises that came out of this dog, made everybody, again, with the new software, we'd be able to show that.
And the dog had been in training before.
Yeah, the dog had been in 6 months of training already. It came in, it was so leash reactive. It was just screaming and barking and it was out of control. And I'm going, wow, you got your plate full. And all this was with a dog walking by. And there's good video. I put a video of that. Now I gave them homework. And I said that I gave them homework. And the homework I gave them was get the dog muzzle conditioned. You're getting a bunch of questions that you'll be able to answer. I gave them a lot of homework. I don't want their dog to do any free roaming. I want their dog kenneled at night. I want their dog kenneled when they're away from the house. I want their dog in place command or downstay at all times. I want limited affection to no affection given to the dog. I want the dog on a structured leash. I want the dog to work for everything it does. I want the dog to be corrected if it comes off of place or if it comes off of out of a down. The dog came back for the second session. Different dog. Totally different dog. Totally different dog. One of the most amazing turnarounds I've ever seen a client do. A client do.
Well, let's bring in, I think it's very important to bring up the client. Obviously, it's, you know.
Talk about those clients.
The husband.
Call about what you observed about the client.
The husband
though.
And wife. But it's children. It's the children.
Four, they have four kids.
They have all boys that are working with this dog. And I think it was the eight-year-old that fed this dog all its meals through the muzzle for the whole entire week. The other boy, the 10-year-old, gets him on the treadmill and has, you know, trained him how to get on the treadmill. So it's not just the parents doing this work. It is young children and asking the most amazing questions that I haven't heard, or, you know, some maybe I haven't even thought of myself. So it's just so important. The only reason this dog came as far as it did is because every single one of those family members were on board. And it was amazing to see. The first week, I think Jeff was just like, you know, with dogs like that, that are reactive, we'll always bring out Girl or Uma and Ronan. We couldn't even do that. I mean, it had already been proven, like, well, no, the dog would not, the energy would not come down. And in 1 week's time, I just see, I think Jeff and I looking at each other like, oh my God, like there is no way at all this dog would ever be a boarding train. So to answer, I think one of the questions I saw in there, that's probably one of the greatest experiences that I've seen since I've been here. Just all the hard work. And yeah, I'm blown away by that. That's for sure. And then I think I saw
somebody asked you what's the
next question, the dog leash.
No, to answer Claire's question first. People, you've been with me for about 2 months. Talk to me about some of your most impactful things you've learned.
Well, that was learned or seen. I thought she said
no,
seeing.
But just learned over the last 2 months. So why don't you tell people your story?
My story is
about taking a freaking chance in life. Talk to your story. Talk about your story.
My story is that I had, I have 2 degrees. I have a psychology degree, HR management degree. I was an HR manager for 10 years. For a lot of those years, probably not very happy. I'll try to sum it all up. Knew I needed a change probably 6 or so months ago. I've always wanted to work with dogs. I've trained my own dogs and then kind of found Jeff and Sean and realized, okay, I guess I'm a balanced trainer because I used prongs and had a lot of the same methods. So started following them, went to Gainesville at the end of January
for a T3,
which was, yeah, amazing on so many different levels, personal, professional, everything. And got the opportunity to come here for a 2-month internship. thought about that for a few weeks. That's a big change.
It was a few weeks.
It was.
You were almost.
You know, I didn't want to give a maybe. It was almost rescinded. Yeah, I just knew I couldn't give a maybe, but I knew I needed a change. And I got out of my comfort zone, said yes, quit my job, and then now I'm here.
So what kind of thing, what's some of the most impactful thing you've learned?
The most impactful thing I've learned. I don't know if impactful is the biggest thing, or is the right word for it. Just every dog is so different. It seems, you know, you can watch so many videos of Jeff's and Sean's and, you know, any other trainer out there that I've been watching, and you still always get a dog where it's different. Mm. Or you get a Stanley, like mm-hmm. I'm sure a lot of you have, where you just totally break the rules. Everything is different. And it's all about troubleshooting. Yeah. And I think that's the biggest thing, especially for new trainers. You get maybe so programmed, oh, well, this is how they did it. And this is what the, you know, the videos said, and that's how they do it. No. I mean,
it doesn't work that way.
It does not work that way at all. You have to take everything you have and be like, okay, well, I saw this done with a dog like that. Maybe it'll work for this type of dog. You know, it's absolutely always different. So that's truly, honestly, I think the thing that I'm going to take home is not just going by the book, because it's not always going to work.
No, it doesn't work. Good. Mm-mm. Awesome. Cool. All right. John and Jigsaw say, actually probably Allison, now that we've been using the remote collar conditioning, lots of hear, sit, break, and recall, it seems like the dog is ignoring commands unless he's getting that remote collar tick. Is it normal to regress? Okay, so what I want you to do now, so chances are, so you've been prompting your dog. What I'd like you to do is I want you to dial up on that remote. And when you get non-compliance on that remote, I want you to give a little bit of a higher stim, because your dog is starting to blow you off. So your dog, you've been doing this now for about 2 weeks. So what I want you to do is I want you to start asking your dog for more accountability. Or what you can start doing is this, is I want you to do the pressure on, pressure off. So what I want you to do is when you say here, it's still going a little bit higher level. Here, you still hold the button, your continuous button down until your dog commits. Sit, you say sit, you hold your continuous button down until the dog fully complies. And then on your down, hold the button down until your dog fully downs. In place, you hold the button down until it fully goes into place. So now it's going to be a little bit of a higher level, and it's going to be on continuous stim. So it's still working level. You're going to do that for a couple of weeks. Let me know how that goes. All right. Let's see. Marianne says, remote observation with my dog this week. Some days he would hear it, and others he'd completely tune out regardless of stim level. So we did some walks at a painfully slow pace, and suddenly my dog is watching me 100% and listening to the remote. Awesome. We have been able to slowly increase pace without any loss in hearing the remote. Okay, good. Good job. Heather, how would you work with a client who already knows everything? I wouldn't work with them, but can you just want to do sessions with you? They have no desire to change anything within the home but want training. How would you approach the client? Heather, why are you working with that client? You don't work with that client. That's not a client you work with. That's called a non-client. You pass. You say, I'm the wrong trainer for you, and I'm the wrong trainer for you. So you don't. That's not a client. So you no disrespect to, because there's a lot of clients out here on this thing. But you know, when I just had a pool company come over and they just did an acid wash on my pool, and they came over with the only thing they borrowed from me was my water, but they brought their own buckets. They brought their own broom things, stiff bristle brushes. They brought their own acid. They brought their own gas masks, the respirators. They brought their own boots, and they did an acid wash on my pool to get all, you know, we've had the pool for 9 years. Like, I'm not going to tell them what to do. You know, my landscaper comes over, he landscapes. My snowplower person comes over, he snowplows. Okay. You know, she has a leak in her guest house. Our handyman came over, he's going to fix it. I'm going to tell him what to do. He's the professional. So when somebody calls you up for dog training and they tries to dictate the training, you tell them goodbye. And if you went to T3, Heather, you'd know that. Okay. So John and Jigsaw and Allison, he always complies with the remote collar. If it's not used, sometimes he listens, sometimes he doesn't. Before the remote, he actually did better with the commands. Huh, that's interesting. That's really interesting. So what you could do is you can go hot. You can go to correction mode on the remote or stop using the remote. If he's doing great without the remote, don't use the remote. Sharon says, recently on a Facebook page, there was a spirited debate. Really? On Facebook pages?
Never.
They have spirited debates? Unheard of. Come on. There's no apple cider vinegar in this.
It doesn't.
Who made this beverage? Let's see. A couple of us contend that a truly well-trained dog was trustworthy, but children also need to be trained to interact appropriately and should always be supervised. Do you agree? And if so, how old before a child can interact without adults around? Your kids look entirely comfortable around dogs, but you're always in the video, of course. So Sharon, I wouldn't trust any dog around kids. I don't trust dogs. I don't trust kids. My kids are different and I still don't have them around. That's not true. That is not true at all. When I travel, my kids take care of the dogs. So they're around my dogs unsupervised. But my kids don't do stupid things ever. We're not talking most of the time. We're not talking some of the time. We're talking ever to the dogs. They know exactly how to be with dogs. And you know how they are? They ignore them. They either tell them what to do or they ignore them. That's what they do. Here's a great example. Is, first of all, can a dog be 100% trustworthy around a child? Let me ask you a better question. Can a human be 100% trustworthy around a child? Let's think of that question. Would you allow, do you trust a human around your child 100%? I don't, right? People make mistakes. Dogs make more mistakes. And they have a mouth full of teeth. And they can jump up on dogs. And when a child cries, most adults run over and pick them up. When a child cries, a lot of dogs will go over and attack. So, but let me tell you about Angelo. Most people know about Angelo. If you don't know about Angelo, go onto my Facebook page and you'll see a lot of Angelo. Angelo is 2 and change right now. When Angelo was 48, this is back when the kennel was at my property. When Angelo is, Sharon says, wow, that's profound. I don't know if that's good or bad. I don't know. Oh, okay. You're talking, what's profound mean?
Like profound, like that's amazing. Oh, you know? Like your kid. I don't know if what she's okay. referring to, maybe your kids never
all right. making. So I'll tell you a couple of different stories. So Angelo, back when the board and training center was on my property, Angelo was born, and when he was 48 hours old, in his little carrier, we used to use him for distraction training. So a bunch of dogs were in a downstay. We put Angelo on the ground by them, or in the place command. But Sharon says, good. Oh, good. Thanks, Sharon.
Yeah,
figured it. Got it. Okay. Speak English, Sharon. Speak English. Profound. So profound is 2-syllable words? Okay. That's a 2-syllable word. Good? That's a 1-syllable word. Okay? Sharon, help me out. 1-syllable words only. Okay? So Angelo did not pet a dog on my property until he was 8 months old. And the first dog he petted was Girl. And Girl is bomb proof. So this is when Angelo was allowed to pet a dog. Girl would be in the playroom, in a downstay or in place. No dog in my house has free roam. And I rarely have dogs in my house. Right now I've got Girl. She's laying down in front of me. I'm sorry, that's Uma. Uma's laying down in front of me. We're just talking about Girls. So Uma's down in front of me. She's lying on the dog bed and she's sleeping. Usually during these webinars, Uma and Girl are both here. Right now, Girl is actually at narcotics school. She's actually training to be our narcotics detection dog. So she'll be able to sniff out marijuana, cocaine, methamphetamine, and heroin. and I'll be hiring her out to, her and I will be a working dog team, and we'll be targeting private industry, manufacturing, cruise ships, and drug and alcohol rehab, well, not alcohol, but drug rehab centers. And you'll be able to hire us to go in and sniff out narcotics. So parents can hire me to make to see if their kids are on drugs, but you know, I mean, whatever. Most, you know, a lot of kids experiment with drugs, myself included. I experimented with a lot of drugs when I was younger. So Angelo didn't meet girl until she was 8 months old, petting. And the day that Angelo knew the concept of no, Angelo was allowed to pet girl. So Angelo was crawling over, crawling. I'm towards girl, and I said, Angelo, no. And Angelo stopped and sat up. And that's the day that he was allowed to pet the dog. So I grabbed Angelo, I put him up on my lap, and I called girl over to me, and I said, do you want to pet the puppy? And Angelo says, yes. And Angelo reached out and pet the dog. But let's keep in mind that, that none of my kids like hug and kiss and usually pet dogs. My kids have been raised to exist around dogs. My children have been raised to have a high respect for dogs and don't treat them like a stuffed animal. My children understand pack leadership and structure, and they understand how to stay safe around dogs. That's not to say they're mean to my dogs. They're not. They're actually better dog handlers than probably most dog trainers I've seen. And that's not because they're my kids. But Angelo can walk into a play yard with 15 dogs, and dogs just leave him alone. Do you know why? Because Angelo doesn't care. Or putting it simply, he doesn't give a shit about the dogs. He just doesn't. He walks and he's like, oh, there's a shiny rock. I'm going to go over and get that shiny rock. And if there happens to be a dog in his way, the dog moves out of his way. He reaches down and he picks up the shiny rock and he gets it. And then he walks over and he puts it into a pile. He'll like go around and get all these like big white stones from the play yard and like put them in a pile. And meanwhile, there's like 15 dogs all running around. The only time that he's ever, you know, I don't want to say gotten hurt, but maybe a dog walking by him that brushes into him and knocks him over. But that's the great thing about Ange. So, you know, Angelo is safer around dogs than other kids because he doesn't put any pressure on dogs. But I think it's really dangerous to, you know, every dog bite call I got, every dog child bite call I get is usually the same thing. I only left them alone for a minute or a second or 5 seconds. And, you know, that's the problem. You don't know what's happening during that time. I've seen children do some of the most dangerous things towards dogs ever. You know, I have, one of my colleagues was at a picnic last summer, and a child walked up to a dog, and it had floppy ears, lifted up the dog's ear and screamed in the dog's ear. Could you imagine that? Could you imagine what incompetent parents must have raised that child? Who does that? Sorry, but who does that? So this was not a special needs child. This was just a child that just had no rules or boundaries or consequences ever laid down to it. And the parent was standing right there and didn't say anything. At some point, this child will lose its face. And that's going to be the parent's fault. And they're probably going to blame the dog. But I'm glad I wasn't there. That's all. So Drew says we still love you. I'm not sure what that's about, but I love you too. No. Jill says, what narcotics school's girl at? She's at actually, she's training with Asa Anderson, who used to run the state narcotics program, and he's active with the state police. Let's see, Ann. Hey, Jeff, working on 4-year-old boxer's aggression toward my other dogs. I'm doing a couple of different things. Number one, put her in place and have the other dogs near her. I definitely keep hold of her leash. Number two, I have them all in the yard. and walk them past them and reward her with mild praise when she ignores them. So depends on how intense the aggression is. I've got my own way. I have my own way of handling it. If it's true aggression, that's, you're just going to be doing avoidance. You won't be eliminating the aggression. So, so what I would do, so, okay, here we go. So Ann says, sorry, don't know why I can't seem to get my question posted in one piece. I've just started the boxer's remote training and she's the first one I've ever tried this on. So I'm a little bit hesitant to try the act of God. I don't blame you and I don't suggest you do it. We learn until we are further along in this aspect of her training. Do you have some other suggestions for anti-aggression I can try with her to be further her training? You can start desensitizing, keep her muzzled, Anne. And I don't suggest owners do active God training when it comes to aggression. I really don't. I think that it's, I would struggle with an owner doing it for dog aggression. I have no problem with you doing it for counter surfing, for eating poop, for getting in the trash, for fence fighting, oh, for going, for picking up socks. And if people are not, wow. Enrique with Meredith and Curtis. Oh my gosh.
Guys.
Hey guys. Hey Enrique. How are you? Enrique should hook up with Asa.
Yeah.
The two of them could probably a darn school. Yeah. I'll talk to Enrique. I'll talk to you about it. We love you guys. What an act of God is this, is the way I fix, and if this is your first time watching this webinar, you know, just keep in mind that remote collars are used for low levels mostly. 90% of the work I do, we work dogs on a lower level than most people can feel. But we absolutely go high on them if we have to. And when we talk about act of God, like jumping up on counters, getting in the trash, eating a sock, we turn the remote up to the highest setting and we wait till the dog does it and then we correct the dog. And we correct the dog with a three count. One, two, three. So yes, you heard me right. If your dog counter surfs, if your dog is counter surfing, and what you do is, just keep in mind, guys, that dogs can die from counter surfing. Dogs can die from eating socks. Dogs can die from getting into the trash. And dogs can get giardia and all kinds of disgusting diseases from eating poop. Okay? So what you're going to do is, a dog's up on the counter, and if the dog gets up onto the counter, you hide. I don't want you to say anything. And we use a remote that's very, very powerful because it needs to override every possible consequence. And we let the dog technically have it for 3 seconds. And does it hurt the dog? It does. It absolutely does. And you're not going to get many dog trainers to even privately say it, to privately do it, or to even publicly, definitely not publicly say it. But I absolutely will sit here today and I will say, if you want to fix counter surfing and some of these other dangerous behaviors, you're going to put the remote on, you're going to go high. You're going to go really high. And is it going to hurt? It absolutely will hurt. Is it going to be fun to watch? It shouldn't be fun to watch. If you get pleasure out of watching it, something's probably wrong with you. Do I get upset? I don't get upset. The reason why I don't get upset is because I know that I'm probably saving the dog's life, and I also stay calm. Anytime I correct a dog on any level whatsoever, it's always from a calm state. So if I've got to correct the dog low, what I would do is I stay calm. So John has a comment, and John, we might disagree on this, John, which is really cool. So John says, I would not use active God aggression unless you know how to choke it out and defend yourself. So good point, John. So John, maybe I'm not sure if, what could happen is John, just to let you know, my protocols with dog aggression is I muzzle the dog and I put it with dogs that won't attack back. And we do the active God with a muzzled dog so it can't latch on. And for choking out, what we would use is we'd use a dominant dog collar. So we're going into a whole other category of dog training right now, folks. So for a lot of folks that don't have intense aggression problems, you know, you might find some of this uncomfortable to hear and be just totally baffled by this conversation. And just keep in mind, though, when it comes to, I separate obedience and behavior into two separate categories. Obedience is sit down, place, recall, heal. When it comes to obedience training, I do none of this stuff. Okay. I do none of this stuff. This is all, you know, technically warm and fuzzy. And yes, when I go to a correction level on obedience, I can be a little bit firmer, but there's no act of God when it comes to obedience training. That's not what I do. It's not my style. That's not how I am at all. But when it comes to behavior, John says, I agree with that. I meant a novice person. Absolutely, John. So we're on the same page. John, I'm going to try to look you up. John, I'm driving from Philadelphia to New Orleans, but I'm probably going straight through. And I'm not, you know what? I'm not going through Virginia Beach. But John, do me a favor. I'd love to hook up with you one day. It's possible. I might be able to send me a private message with your address and your contact information. John, that's if you want to meet me.
You're being very presumptuous. Right.
John's going, Jeff, the reason why I got a pseudonym here is because I don't ever want to meet you at all. But I think John's an active participant in my webinars.
No, yeah.
John, we're good for a lunch date, right? Come on. Lunch, Mexican food, Thai food. Come on, right? So, yeah, I don't think that a novice should ever work with a okie doke. And I just got bumped out. And I'm bumped out, guys. If you can hear me, the issue is that I cannot see anything going on. And I know it's not you. I had to do that again.
No, now we are.
Okay, now we're on there again. I don't know what happened. I've done that once before, starting it from the beginning to start talking.
Mm-hmm.
I know.
We've been talking to you guys for a little bit. You just didn't hear us.
No, we were just having a massive technical difficulty here.
We're back.
I know. Major technical difficulties today. Actually, this is the second week in a row we've had really bad technical difficulties. So
it's different though.
Yep. We've had problems this week. We had problems at Wednesday. We had problems this Saturday on the radio show.
We had to go out of HD. We're back, John.
But we're having problems here. So we got to figure this out. And it is the internet connection. Or it's the software. And hopefully with the new software upgrade, right? Right. All right. Drew said, yep, thanks, Doug. Yep. Drew said, thanks, Jeff. Late getting back here. I will definitely work on more attention work in public places with Dublin. How can I introduce him to my brother's dog that he has previously had aversion towards? What I would do is this. I mean, the best advice I can give for a dog that has been struggling with other dogs is I want you to always be in motion right now. So let's do some migration work, which is I want you to go move. So you go for structured walks, Then I want you to work on duration work. So both dogs in place, both dogs in a down stay, and get dogs to just be around each other. Work on existence first. So work on existence first before you try to interact. So it's also, you want the dogs to be calm. The biggest problem is most owners are not dog trainers. Thanks, John. Yeah, lunch will be great. Email me, get a hard line. I know.
On the list.
We got to figure something out. But Heather says I might not have to do that, but I don't think a hard line is going to be a bad thing, but we'll figure something out here. You know, I do these Monday and Wednesday webinars. They're getting bigger and bigger every week. I'm not going to stop doing them. I do them twice a week. They're 100 minutes each, and I can't be having technical difficulties because I can only imagine on your end, on the other people's end of the line, how annoying that must be. And I got an obligation to my fans to put on a quality show, and this is ridiculous that we have to do this. Also, I started asking questions. The chat is open now. So
I remember one, or I think I saw Doug asked a question about like how I handle people.
He just wants to, we've talked about that so many times.
Problem.
Set up the situation first of
so,
all.
So I'll give a perfect situation because I deal with it every day. Area here, Blackstone, lots of people, lots of dogs. I'm out running with Ruby every day. People have their dogs on flexies all over the place. The other day, Gal had two dogs. One was on flexi coming over to us. I made eye contact with me. I could tell wanted to talk with me. Yeah, just has no control over a dog. Let her dog just come over. The first thing I always do is put my body between their dog and my dog first and foremost, because I have to be Ruby's advocate. And she's like, well, you know, my dog, you know, is friendly, wants to say hi. And I'm like, no, you know, I don't introduce my dogs on leash first. I just don't. And you could tell she kind of thought I was rude. And in that instance, I just kept going. There's no need to have a conversation about it. You just keep going. Mm. I've had instances where I have been standing there. They've approached me. Well, I don't want to leave an area if I'm doing something and I try to, you know, hey, I'm training, I'm this, I'm that. But the biggest thing is if you have to get rude, you have to get rude. Because there was a time where even I was rude and very point blank, like, no, do not approach my dog and I. And my dog that I don't have any longer got bit on the head from her very friendly lab. Obviously not so much. So don't ever have a problem with being rude and saying no, because people, it annoys people. And it's like, they even want to come up to you even more. And it's no, you can't do it. Do not introduce dogs face to face on leash or dogs you don't even know, people you don't even know, especially if they're all over the place. And yeah, it's just not safe. Nothing good comes of it.
So that's your protocol.
That's my protocol.
Pretty much the same. Pretty much the same as my protocol.
Well, it is, but you know, they like to see that a nice woman's touch does the same thing.
So Doug says an act of God knocked you out of the webinar when you bashed my question. It's right, Doug. It's true.
See, I brought it back.
It's true. John says hardline will really help cut down the audio delay. I know. We're gonna do it. Don't worry. John and Jigsaw say on the focus work, how long should the dog be able to focus without breaking eye contact? We're up to about 5 seconds or so. Awesome. That's really good. So what I want you to do though, John, Allison, is when the dog is looking at your eyes, remember you're saying good, 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 and then break. So that good, 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 you want to let your dog know that good is, it's really, really important. So, right, got it. So that good is reassuring that the dog is in the right eye contact. So that's beautiful. So the next thing you can start doing is start adding some distractions around your dog. Okay. All right, we need more questions. I know people are probably afraid to ask questions now because we get bumped out.
Bumped out or yelled at?
Yeah. What else should I talk about? I just posted up this really cool video. I just, let's see. I won't, okay, cool. Oh, cool. All right. So, hey John, what's up? So this is the thing is I just put up this, great little video of this young man, and I know he's on the autism spectrum. And it was funny because when he first came in, his name is Matt, and he came in with his dog Harvey, and when he first came in, and I'm really good with kids, I work with a lot of kids, and he's, I hate to use the word special needs because I'm special needs, but just to, you know, obviously he struggles with a couple of things, and he struggles with some attention stuff. He struggles with spatial stuff. He's known to just go up to people and hug them. And he runs up to a lot of dogs, and obviously he can be really loud, and he's non-focused. But it was funny because he came in, and before I sort of corralled him in to the dog training, he was picking up the stun sticks.
Oh no!
It was like no. So I had to mat proof the training center. He picked up the radio, and he's like starts talking to the radio. So Matt's voice is going all over the center, and he's a really cool kid. He's 11 years old, and he's a really great guy. And I made a little video about his day today with me, his hour with me today. So if folks want to see it, they can go to my Facebook page, either my personal page or my business page, and they can see Matt. And we had a really great time. And Matt, if you're watching now, I love you, buddy. You did a great job, and I'm really proud of you. So he's this really, really cool kid. But anyway, so it's great because once somebody, you know, the biggest thing I think that's missing in successive dog training is the dedication of the owner. Peter, watch this video. You'll appreciate it. Peter works with a lot of kids. So I think what's missing is, I hate to use the word laziness in owners because, you know, I want people to realize that I think owners, they want good dogs, but sometimes they just don't know how to do it. And also I think that some training systems are just so, you don't see results fast enough, which don't get me wrong. I mean, I know we live in a fast society, and I know we're a society that wants stuff fast, myself included, but I think taking 6 months to get your dog to walk on a leash is a little bit pushing it. I think there's a lot of trainers out there that, that manipulate the public by getting them to sign up for more and more classes, which isn't to say we wouldn't do that, but if we're going to have you sign up for more classes, we're going to keep teaching you new stuff. So I don't think it doesn't take like 4 sessions to train a dog how to do a downstay. But anyway, we're getting some questions, and we better get to those. Katie says, what would Jeff do immediately after breaking up a dog fight? Do you make them lie on their side near each other? Anything? Okay. So we don't do alpha roles. So I don't do an alpha role. I'm not opposed to it. I just don't do it. Most people do alpha roles. They do it wrong. Most people use the alpha role as a corrective tool. It's actually wrong. That's actually how you get bit. So I think that if you're trying to roll a dog over to get it to stop being reactive, it's a matter of time before you get bit in the face. Once the dog has stopped the bad behavior and is in a calmer state, if you roll it over, I can see possibly the value in that. I just don't do it. To me, that's not something I do, which is fine. There's a lot of people that don't do what I do. So I'm okay with all that. So what I definitely do is after a dog fight, it all depends on if there was any injuries, how the extent of the injuries were, if there's any human injuries at all. I address the humans first. Bottom line is, in my book, humans are more important than dogs. My staff is more important than anything out there. So I have to make sure my staff is safe. If my staff is safe, what we'll do is we probably separated the dogs. First of all, it's been a while since we've had a dog fight. We had a little skirmish the other day, which was human error back in the kennel area, but I wouldn't consider that a fight. That was just a quick scuffle. But an all and out dog fight, we most likely wouldn't have because when we are dealing with a dog aggressive dog, our first thing we do is we do avoidance training. So what we do is we make it so that dog wants to avoid other dogs. So now they're safe. So we get the dog to go into avoidance, and then we do acceptance, and then we see what goes on from there. But the best way to break up a dog fight is not to have a dog fight. That's why I like to control every dog on the property, and I like to control the situation. That's why I like muzzles, and that's why I like my electronics. So I know there's people out there that are teaching on how to choke dogs out with like a rear naked choke. I'm sorry, but I think that's really bad to do. I think asking even a trained dog trainer to do that is, first of all, why would you do that when you can use electronics or use a dominant dog collar and a leash and just do the same thing with a dominant dog collar and a leash instead of getting down by a dog's biting face and putting it into a chokehold? And to expect an owner to do that, I just think that's just crazy. Mm-hmm. Let's keep in mind too, guys, you can use fear to stop a bad behavior. You can use fear. And let me give you the best example. Right now, I mean, I don't touch Diana's boobs because I'm afraid of her. I don't touch her boobs because it would be really disrespectful. But let's say, I don't know, let's say if I did touch her boobs and she like punched me in the face, broke my nose, kicked me in the nuts, and put me in the hospital. You know, I probably would be afraid to do that again. But maybe that's a wrong example. But so would I not do it because I'm afraid of her? Or, I mean, I wouldn't do it because it's not the right thing to do. So I guess that's not a good example.
Well, if you were to do it, though, and I did that, then you wouldn't do it again because you were afraid.
Right, exactly.
That's what I think the point you're trying to make.
Right.
Like, once there's some fear invoked, all right, then you're going to freaking think twice about doing
it. Exactly.
Like that.
So a better example maybe is why don't you walk in front of buses? Yeah. You know? Why don't you walk in front of, because that's an obvious, but see, that's an obvious one. I was trying to give a,
well, yeah, and I think,
like, trying to give another one, which was,
you've said it before. Like, if I were to be like, oh, just knock that off, you'd probably do it again. Same with a dog. If a dog is going to do something, you know, that you don't want it to do, and you're just like, okay, please stop, they're going to do it again because they're not fearful of it.
Yeah, that's talking more about like stopping jumping. But I get it, yeah.
I think what you're saying, yeah. I mean, it gets down to the same thing where it has to be aversive enough to where there is some
right,
fear.
Exactly.
Like, they do not you don't want your nose broken again.
Right.
They don't want that punishment.
So if I were to grab your boobs and you were just like, stop, Jeff, to me, that's foreplay.
Yeah.
Like, in most guys, it is, because we're stupid. So to me, that's foreplay. So,
but if I were to like, just punch
I'd be like,
lights out, you're like, bah!
Okay. Right. I got it. So you didn't want me touching your boobs, is what you're saying.
So is that what you're trying to tell me?
Right. And trust me, with this is a sort of, as Diana is, if she wanted me to touch her boobs, she'd freaking tell me to do it. So until I hear that conversation, it ain't gonna happen. It's not gonna happen. So I guess a bigger issue is why don't you stand in front of buses because you're afraid of dying? Right? Why don't you stand in front of a train? You're afraid of dying. Why don't you go through red lights? You're afraid of possibly getting into a car accident or getting a ticket. Why don't you speed when you see a police officer in your rearview mirror? Start driving 95 miles an hour. No. Why? Because you're afraid of getting a ticket. So when it comes to rehabilitating aggression, my protocol is I'm going to make that dog deathly afraid to do it again. Absolutely. So John says, you don't ever want your face close to a dog, no matter how good you are. It's not necessary with all the protocols available. It's only inviting a chance to let the dog make a mistake. We're supposed to set the dog up for success, not mistake. Come in. Hold on, guys. Hold on. You going to bed? Angelo.
Later.
No hug, no kiss. Angelo, people want to say goodnight to you. So you know, John, you're right. There's so many protocols that you could be using that that you don't need to ever be bending down and choking a dog out. So I just think that's a little bit weird that people would do that or even teach that. Claire says, you lost the questions. I asked about recommending a single remote or multi-dog remotes for the multi-dog family. I have three dogs. You can get if you already have a 300, keep your 300 and then get a 302, and then you'll have to buy a 302. But also, if you get the easy one, the 900, that's expandable up to four dogs. But if you wanted, probably the least expensive way for you to do is just get a 302. Jill says, do you think it would be possible to have the dog not eat the cat food? I want to leave it out in the hallway and have full access. Jill, why don't you just put the cat food up high? Mm-hmm. And how long does it take your dog? I have a cat. The cat eats the cat eats the cat food in like 3 minutes. So our cat eats, I think, once a day, and it eats the freaking food.
Really? See, most people I know, the cat's food is out all day, and they don't.
Yeah. So then your cat's not hungry. Yeah. Okay. So your cat's not hungry. So no, Jill. Terry says, can you give any teasers about T3 in Dallas? I'm super excited, but also feeling overwhelmed. Then if I give you teasers, you'll overwhelm you even more. No.
You will love it. I don't know what's happening there. But
you have to wait. You got to wait. Doug says, is there a time to use a prong collar with the largest lynx? So if you're the largest lynx, I think, are 4 millimeter. I guess if you're training a mountain lion, seriously, if you're training a mountain lion, I can see, seriously.
But even three, we don't use a lot. Like, when would you even use a three? I mean, I've noticed even when we get big dogs in.
We use a 3 millimeter on most of them.
The big dogs?
Yeah.
Well, no, I've noticed there's some big dogs. And
we use the 225, but your dogs, like all your German Shepherds, all your Rottweilers are all going to be on threes. All your Huskies are going to be on threes. Any
ever use the four?
God, no.
No, we don't even have
it. No. I would never use a four.
I
wouldn't even use a 3.25. So the answer is no, Doug. John and Jigsaw and Allison doing the wave dance distraction, some work outside, telling him good. Should he eventually be able to hold focus as long as I'm telling him good? Yes. But you had a young puppy with high levels of distraction. Tia, have you ever used a remote collar with a walkie-talkie? I bought one, but it scared my pup. No, I don't like those. So the walkie-talkie, I think the CB radio. So what happens is I don't like those at all. So if you're a dog trainer, first of all, if you're a private person, you don't have to use that at all. If you're a dog trainer and you're trying to train the public or your client, when you're pushing the button, what you can do is just hold your arm up. But also, I explain to my clients when I'm using the button, and it's pretty simple to understand. So say I'm teaching the down command. So I would say down, and I'd hold the button. And then as soon as I said good, the button would be off. So I tell my client, when I give the down command, the button is engaged. When I say good, you know the button is off. So I would do that. So no, I don't like them. I find them personally annoying, and the dog could freak out the dog. Jill says she's fed meals, but she grazes. Then she's not hungry enough. I just wanted to know if there's a possibility it makes it easier on us. But we also have a hissy kitten. So why are you free feeding your cat? I don't know anything about cats. So then I've got a cat, and it eats in 5 minutes or less. And if your dog is great, if your cat is grazing, that means you're feeding it too much. At least that's what I say with people with dogs. So I don't know. I don't have cats. We have one cat here.
Jack has a cat.
Yep. We have chickens coming in soon too. We got our chickens. Let's see. Any last questions, guys? We got 9 more minutes that I'm willing to do the show for. And this Wednesday show is going to be this Saturday I'm going to be in Germany. I'm going to Germany. John, I'm not reading that. Okay. Sorry.
It's going to be the radio.
Yeah. I leave. What am I going to Germany? Thursday? Thursday night, I'm going to Germany. I'm working with a bunch of clients. I'm sold out. My client thing is sold out, so I can't work with any more clients in Germany. And so Linda will be here Wednesday doing the radio show with me, and we're going to be in a radio show format. And then next Monday, I don't know what time I'm coming back. I might not do it next. We'll find out. I'll let everybody know because I'm coming back on Monday. No, it's a five. No, it's not till late. I take a 5 o'clock flight out of Germany, 6 hours difference. I arrive 7 hour flight. arrive at 8, Boston back. Now I won't be able to make it. I won't be able to make it. So Jill said she's not free fed. Yes, she is.
You're just leaving it now.
Jill, you said she grazes all day. That's free feeding. But she's fed. I'm arguing with her, with Jill. I can't. She's only 13. I got to stop arguing with her. But she's fed an appropriate amount 2 times a day and usually eats it all, but has recently left some in her bowl because she's on a diet food. So she's leaving it on a bowl. Take it away, right? It's like raising kids.
Maybe.
Tracy wants to know, is Diana coming to Gainesville, RV dog trainer with you? Well,
we're talking about it, Tracy.
We don't know. There's a couple.
Jeff's going to say right now, but we talked about it.
So I really need Diana at the training center, but her best friend lives in Gainesville.
And I want to be at the seminar.
And she wants to be at the seminar, but I probably don't need her to work at the seminar because there's going to be so many T3ers that can help me out. But she would learn a lot. I don't know. And I got to get her a ticket. I got to fly her down there. And I really need her back home. But we're going to see. We're going to figure it out. She's definitely not coming down in the RV because I've got to go. Sure. Yeah, I got to fly her down because I'm going to New Orleans first. We're doing New Orleans Accelerate. So we don't know.
And I hope to see you, Tracy.
Yeah. Doug says, can you tell us the outcome for Rocky, the Ridgeback mix that was very aggressive? We don't know. He did fine with us here. We don't know what's happening back at home. I don't know. You never know. You never know. You know, when we check in with clients, they just say, yep, everything's going fine. Thank you so much. Sometimes clients wait to the last, you know, let's see, the dog trainer arguing with a crazy cat lady who works at a cat rescue. You're right, Jill. I'm not going to argue with you. You win. I know, Jill. I know. So I don't know what happened with Rocky. Obviously a lot of time is, you know, one of the things that we do with our social media is we're really big on showing, you know, the process and a lot of photos, but we're also really big on privacy of our clients. And excuse me, I'm sorry. No, you guys aren't putting me to sleep. My lack of sleep is putting me to sleep. It's damn 5 a.m. wake up calls. So what's happening is once they go back to the family's home, we keep it really private. We keep it private. The reason why we keep it private, because some of there might be some legal issues as well with the rehabilitation of an aggressive dog. So we like to keep things really, really private for the owner. So out of respect for the owner, we usually don't publicly follow through with them. A lot of our owners, though, do go to group classes that are local. Rocky was one of our out-of-state clients. So if it's a group class dog, you'll see them all the time. And then that's, you know, you see a lot of that, but we do a lot of out-of-state business, a lot of aggression rehab. And then we'll refer them to a local trainer to keep up with it. So, excuse me. So that's the story. Go to rvdogtrainer.com, rvdogtrainer.com. It looks like I'm doing another seminar in the Quebec, Montreal area that we'll be announcing soon. It looks like I'm doing one in Tucson, Arizona that I'm announcing soon. I'm working on a UK one for August that I'll be announcing soon. Possibly Wisconsin I'll be announcing soon. So it looks like there's between T3 and RV about 25 seminars this year. It's a lot of seminars. I know. Wow. I know. It's a lot. And then there's just a lot of people that need help. Wow. You know, there's a lot of people that need help. Jill says check the poll. End poll. The poll was, is your dog in place or in down while you watch the webinar? 72% say yes. 28% say no. And of those 28%, 20% don't have a dog. So, no, I'm just kidding. I don't know.
You made that.
I made that part up. So, all right. So there you go, Jill. Great question, Jill. Next week's poll is how many people let their cat free feed? Doug says, great webinar. Thanks for putting these on. People are starting to watch some of them as I posted them on Facebook. Great. Awesome, Doug. Thanks. Thanks for all the publicity. We love you, buddy. All right. So rvdogtrainer.com, train the trainers with Sean and Jeff.com. And oh, sallycaninetraining.com. We have a new, brand new website being launched tomorrow. Tomorrow. It's going to be on the, for all my folks out there that own websites. The 21st is tomorrow, which is when your website has to be mobile friendly or you will be penalized by search engines. So that's not, you don't have to do it, but you'd be foolish not to do it.
Google is favoring the ones that are mobile friendly.
Okay. Larry's also from Virginia. Come to Virginia Beach. We can do Mexican food with John. All right. Jill says, how do you deal with him? How do you deal with me?
It's not dealing. It's a good time.
We have a good time.
I know. It's really not dealing.
We do.
I'd like to give him our dumb, but no, it's just, yeah.
Yeah.
It just is.
Yeah. There's all, don't get Diana wrong. There's a ton of people that can't stand me, but I think that the people that can stand me are the ones that are going to be really successful because for some reason they get it. You know, they get it. They understand what it takes to be, they understand the passion. They understand what it takes to be great. They understand hard work. They understand sacrifice. They understand that everything in life is not easy. And they also understand that also growth is constant. And that's the important thing. All right.
Thank you guys.
So Larry and John, John and Larry know each other. Awesome, guys. I'll have to get down there. I'm scooting my Philadelphia to New Orleans thing is going not past you, I think. I'll look on a map, but I'm pretty sure I'm not going to Virginia, but I'd like to. I'll let you know. Larry and John, somebody send me an email with contact information or a private message on Facebook so I can, let me just see what my schedule is, but I'm probably going to do a big drive. All right. Oh, Larry, you just titled your dog in Schutzen. Congratulations. Nice. All right. Good job, buddy. Good job. All right, everyone.
Good night.
Good night. I love you guys. I really do. I love it. I love that you guys are so passionate about attending these. I love it how you keep showing up. I love it how you participate. I love it how you ask questions. You know, keep spreading the word. I mean, what people can do is when I post these webinars on Facebook, you can share them. I mean, that's what you can do. A lot of people say, "Hey, what can we do?" Just share the webinar, share the ones that have already been done, and then share the link for people to sign in. That's all. That's what we can do. All right. Everyone have a great night.